Before we kick things off, I would like everyone to take note of the exits, the fire exits that are to my left, to my right, also behind you, all the way up at the tippy top, there are fire exits, and of course, the door that you came in. So with that, we're going to kick things off. Welcome to the 2022 Department of Communication Annual Celebration of Excellence and Honor Society Induction Ceremony. My name is Andrew Utterback, and I am the chair of the Department of Communication. I want to sincerely welcome our guests to Eastern today, friends and family. Thank you for coming to campus to join us. I would also like to thank President Nunez, Provost Salka, and Dean Pandey for participating in our ceremony today. We are truly honored. Thank you. Our ceremony today honors excellence, in all facets of our communication program. Awards will be given to students in the following categories: radio, television news and sports, journalism, communication research, and video production. Also in our ceremony today, we will present the National Communication Society Scholar Award and induct 32 new members into the Lambda Pi Eta National Communication Honor Society. But for all of our honorees today, I would like to recognize what I would like to call the endurance of excellence. Eastern, the Department of Communication, our faculty, and most importantly, our students have endured. For the last 25 months, we have endured. And I will repeat the words, endurance with excellence. To perform at a high level under pandemic conditions is all the more remarkable and is an achievement to be proud of. I would now like to invite Dr. William Salka, Provost and Vice President of Academic Affairs, to provide opening remarks.
Thank you very much, Dr. Utterback. And let me just start by thanking all of you, particularly the students, for having me here. It is a great honor to be invited to speak, and I will be brief because I learned long ago no one comes to these events to hear me speak, particularly when the president is on the program as well. I've been at Eastern for 22 years. I came here as a professor, and is right out of graduate school, and I've been provost for four, and this, beyond anything, is my favorite time of year, because we look forward to commencement and saying goodbye to our graduating seniors, but not goodbye forever, saying goodbye as they take the next step in their careers or their lives. And it's also events like this, where we get to celebrate the incredible work that our students do. And so thank you very much. It is a great honor to be here. I would like to welcome all of the family and friends of tonight's honorees. I hope you are as proud of your students as we are. But I would like to ask the students to just take a moment and acknowledge the very talented faculty in the communication department. These faculty have played an enormous role in the success that you've had, that success that we're celebrating tonight. They have worked tirelessly to teach and mentor you over the last few years, and that task, that job, has been made all the more difficult under COVID. So please join me in just asking the faculty to stand and having the students just applaud them. But tonight it is truly about the students. I would like to congratulate you on the accomplishments that are going to be recognized today, whether it's the induction into the Honor Society or the awards that are going to be given. You should be proud of how far you've come so far, and you should be excited about how much further you will go. I would like to offer some brief advice as you prepare to end the semester, and for some of you, it will be your last semester at Eastern. First, I would like to encourage you to remember that you are receiving, and when you graduate, you will have received a liberal arts education. And that, to me, is the most important thing that you will take from Eastern. You will no doubt be successful in whatever field you pursue, but being liberally educated means more than that. It means that the world is going to expect a bit more from you than just having a very successful career. We and the world are going to expect you to be lifelong learners. And what this means is to be open to learning new things and adapting as the world around you changes, right, far beyond the time your formal education ends. You need to be open to new experiences and try new things well throughout your life, right? If I hadn't done that, I would not be in the position I am today. And so I encourage you to do that, because by learning and exploring new things, again, long after your formal education ends, you will develop new knowledge and find ways to improve the world around you. You'll find ways to be leaders in your field and in your communities. My last bit of advice is to always appreciate how fortunate you are to have accomplished all that you have. When your careers are underway, and you will no doubt be wildly successful in those careers, always remember that some of that success is owed to the people who helped you get there, right? The people who have helped you along the way. These are your family, these are your friends, and these are your professors. And years from now, when you're enjoying the success that you have, it's important to think of them and reach out and thank them for all that they've done. But it's also important to help others, to give back, right? To help others just as others have helped you get to where you are. And I'm going to ask you tonight, when you're doing that, to particularly think of Eastern and the communication department. And I'm going to ask you to help the next generation of students that come after you. You can do this in a lot of ways. You can take on an intern. You can mentor a student. You can serve on an advisory board. Or you can donate to a scholarship fund to help another student get the same outstanding education that you did. So when you go on to these great things that we know you will, I hope that when you leave Eastern, you will take a piece of Eastern with you, and that you will always remember your time here. So again, congratulations, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Provost Salka. It is now my very great pleasure to introduce to you our next speaker this evening, the President of Eastern Connecticut State University, Dr. Elsa Nunez.
Thank you, Dr. Utterbuck. I'm wearing sunglasses because I had eye surgery in my left eye. The doctor said I have to wear the mask so I don't get COVID while I'm recuperating from the surgery. I feel like I've been hit by a train. But I wouldn't miss this affair for anything in the world. I said to my husband, I got to get there. I'll wear sunglasses, my mask, and take it off only for a few minutes while I greet you and congratulate my fabulous students. Let's give them, the students, a round of applause. I'm a parent, so I know how your family and friends who are here on your behalf are just beaming with pride for your accomplishments. I'm delighted to be here with you this evening because I am so proud of the work of the Communication Department. It's under the leadership of Andrew Utterback. You heard him speak earlier as the MC of this affair, and he provides very strong leadership, and our academic departments are as strong as the leaders who lead them. So thank you for all that you've done, Professor Utterback. And my faculty colleagues, they stood up before. I want to acknowledge you and thank you for all that you do for the students, your mentorship, your tutelage, all of the guidance that you give them over the years. But today's a sad day for me as president. Two of my colleagues in the Communication Department are retiring, and they'll be honoring during today's activities Dr. Chabot and Dr. Gomez. Dr. Chabot is not able to be with us today, but Dr. Gomez is. I'd like him to stand and say congratulations on your retirement. But you shouldn't go. You should go. You should stay another 30 years here. He's done a fabulous job as a faculty member. So I want to thank the family and friends of our Honor Society inductees and other awardees for supporting your students. We share the pride, as I said. It is a profound sense of pride that we have when you accomplish so much. I would be remiss if I did not remind everyone in the room that tonight is a very special night, and that's why I couldn't miss it and send someone to represent me. We have not held an on-the-ground event honoring our communication students since 2019. That's 3 years ago, the last time we gathered together to honor our students. I think I can say with certainty that each of us have friends or family who have suffered so much, even lost their lives due to the COVID crisis. And our hearts go out to these families and to our friends. But those of us who are here tonight are not only fortunate to be part of this evening's celebration in person, we are stronger as a community at Eastern and more resilient from the past 2 years of the global pandemic. We really, really made things work for our faculty, staff, and students as a community. I encourage everyone to use what we have learned during the time to start new beginnings and celebrate new triumphs in the future. I know our students have much to look forward to as seniors among them graduate in a few weeks to start a new chapter of their lives. Not everyone is a social worker or a biologist, to name but two of our 40 majors at Eastern, but all Eastern students are communicators. In fact, the ability to communicate, how to write professionally, public speaking, presentation skills, those are part of our core values or core learning outcomes here at Eastern, and they're part of the liberal arts core. We have five: critical thinking, creativity, ethical reasoning, and quantitative literacy. The provost mentioned how important it is to be liberally educated, because when you leave Eastern, you can talk about the conflict in the Middle East, the role of religion in this country, you can talk about your discipline, whether it was radio or television or writing or journalism, you can talk about all of those things, but you're more broader than your major, and that's the gift that Eastern has given you. While all Eastern students gain communication skills, the students in the communication department take it much, much further. You are professional communicators that the rest of us depend on for our news every day, entertainment, and for exploration of the world. You are the people we count on to help solve the challenges facing our society. When you turn on the radio, when you turn on the television, when you read an article, you're looking for direction from all of you. Through discourse, dialogue, and debate, you provide it for us. When I look at the different awards being presented tonight, I am reminded of how broad the field of communication is and how fortunate our students are to practice their skills in so many ways, through print, through radio, TV, and orally, and on campus during internships and in all the arenas you have participated in. The hands-on learning available to communication majors gives our graduates a range of career opportunities. They get jobs in publications, in photography, design, radio, television, public relations, journalism, digital media, and media research. Congratulations to each of the students this evening. We are also inducting 50 members into the Lambda Pi Eta National Honor Society for Communication Students, which is a national organization and one that is very, very difficult to be inducted in. The name Lamba Paeta represents the Aristotle, as Aristotle described in his book Rhetoric, the three artistic proofs of persuasion: logos, lamba, meaning logic; pathos, pi, relating to emotion; and ethos, eta, defined as character and ethics. I know each of you seeks in your own way to communicate with reason, with passion, because you each show your passion in the work that you do in the classroom, and within a personal code of ethics that Eastern has given you during the 4 years that you've been here. Hold these values dear to your heart, and you will always, always do well. You will soon join other graduates who are working at television stations, in public relations agencies, in state government, and in the corporate sector, here in Connecticut, as well as across the country. I know you will do well and succeed in all that you try. Without their guidance and support, our students could not be here tonight because of the support that the faculty has given them and have led you to be inducted in the Honor Society. In addition to leading classroom discussions on mentoring, hands-on learning, the faculty have also updated the curriculum over the past few years, and we're thankful to all of them who've done this work. All this learning is taking place in our new communication building. How many of you have been in it to see it? You should take a tour. It's a beautiful building. It was an old building that we renovated, and the students love it. We have a radio station, a TV station, video, editing labs, and more. This is the state-of-the-art technology that gives students a competitive edge in competing for today's jobs. Your taxes and my taxes pay for all of those facilities, for the education that they're getting. You should be very proud as a citizen of Connecticut that we've invested in higher education in Connecticut so that these young people could be the beneficiaries of those investments. Remember what the German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche said. He said, "All I need is a piece of paper and something to write with, and then I can turn this world upside down." Believe me, each of you will take a piece of paper, write on it, and turn the world upside down. Congratulations. Don't tell my husband it was more than 5 minutes.
Thank you, President Nunez. I would now like to invite Professor John Zatowski to the podium to present the awards for excellence in radio.
I don't know much about Shakespeare, but I think it was Hamlet in his first soliloquy said, "To mask or not to mask? That is the question." So I will unmask. It's my great pleasure to introduce Carla Pacheco. She has been the mainstay of our operation for the last 3.5 years. She said she was drawn to WECS by accident, but I think it was divine intervention. The radio waves pulled her in, and she has been the mainstay of our operation as our student, program manager, director, training, in front of the microphone and back of the microphone. We couldn't have done it without her, pre-COVID, COVID, and post-COVID. So I'm gonna ask Carla to come over here and present the remainder of her staff here. So I guess we can sort these out.
All right. Our first award goes to a host of What I Got, Kate Berry, featuring live music performances and interviews.
There's the next one here.
Our next award goes to Janelle Chase, host of Getting Through Life with JC, featuring phenomenal advice and story time. Our next award goes to Eden Fritz Aguiar, host of Get Schooled with Eden, featuring current events on and off campus.
And finally, to Carla Pacheco, Excellence in Radio. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Zatowski. Now it is my honor to present the next group of awards to the students of Eastern Television. For the past 17 years, I have had the pleasure to be one of the faculty advisors to the Eastern Television Group, more commonly known today as ETV. One activity of the ETV group is the weekly production of a newscast, ETV News. It's a 30-minute, entirely student-produced news program. Throughout the academic year, the ETV Sports Group also produces hours and hours of live coverage of ECSU sporting events for the Department of Athletics. This includes every home game of every varsity sport. I am pleased to report to you that the ETV group has grown over the years into a very powerful social and professional group of students and alumni. Former ETV students are working for nearly every television operation in the state of Connecticut, as well as ESPN, NBC Universal, CBS New York, NBC Boston, Fox New York, stations in Ohio, Tennessee, Kansas, Massachusetts, and New York. Annually, it is my honor to recognize the graduating seniors of the ETV group. On a personal note to the honorees, I'll miss you. Keep in touch. Please join me in honoring the ETV class of 2022. When your name is called, please step forward to receive your award. As an aside, a few of the students, a lot of the students from ETV Sports, cannot be with us today. ETV Sports is covering a softball doubleheader and a baseball game today at the same time. Right now. So they're busy. And that's fine. That's fine. Jake Bolduc. Is Jake here? Not here. Janelle Chase. Janelle. You're welcome. We're going to do a picture. Manar Anani. Kyle Ferguson. Congratulations, buddy. Dropping stuff. Ryan Gable's probably at a softball field. Zachary Greer. John Pellegrino. Congratulations, guys. I would now like to invite Dr. Needy Pandey, Interim Dean of the School of Education and Professional Studies, to present the National Communication Association Scholar Award.
Good evening, everyone. It is an honor to be a part of the Communication Department's Celebration of Excellence. I have the distinct pleasure of announcing the NCA Scholar Award this evening, given to a student with strong academic achievement and demonstrated commitment to the field of communication. Tonight's award recipient embodies these characteristics and more. Exemplifying Eastern's liberal arts values, she has presented at undergraduate research conferences, guest lectured in our first year introduction class, produced creative content for clients as a media intern, been a member of clubs and professional organizations, and has earned the distinction by being placed on the Dean's List. Please join me in congratulating the recipient of the NCA Scholar Award, Emily Hailu.
This one? Okay. First of all, I'd like to thank the Communication Department for this award. Haven't won anything since fifth grade, which is a spelling bee, so this is a step up for me. When I first came to Eastern and was deciding on a major, I had no idea what I wanted to do. I just knew I hated math and science, so I had to like stay away from that. And I found communication. I took Introduction to Mass Communication my first semester here, and I immediately knew that's what I wanted to do. And I think I could speak for all of us when I say the major question we get is, what do communications majors even do? And I usually reply, I don't know, we just like communicate. But like, I know it's much more than that. We are marketers, advertisers, producers, writers, social workers, and so much more. And that is what I love about the Communication Department, is you could do so much and you don't have to choose a single thing. There is a lot of things you could do with communication which a lot of people don't realize, but that is what I love about this department. The department here at Eastern has helped me grow both academically and professionally. I was first given the opportunity to present at the CREATE conference when I was a freshman, and I could say with my whole heart that is the best academic decision I could have made, because that prompted me to go on and present at the COPLAC conference and be a guest speaker, take an independent study, become a resident assistant, and complete two internships, all with the help of the Department of Communication here at Eastern. So for that, I am so grateful. For all the Lambda Pi Eta inductees here today, if I could give one piece of advice, it would be to take that risk. If I did not take that risk of presenting at the conference or taking internships, I would not be where I am here today, so I'm so thankful for that. One major lesson I learned this year that was also portrayed in Chris Colfer's Struck by Lightning is that no matter how far-fetched your dream is, no matter how unrealistic you may think your dream is, somebody has to get that position, somebody has to have that job that you want, so why can't it be you? Lastly, I have to thank my amazing parents. I would not be here today if it was not for them. And no one pushes me harder to do well in school than them, so I am so thankful for that, because I probably would not have the grades that I do today if it wasn't for them. Ever since elementary school, my dad would say, A is for adoption, I want A+. So you could see how that would scare a 9-year-old me into getting good grades. So thanks, Dad. Love you. And once again, thank you to my parents, the Communication Department, my classmates, and Eastern as a whole for shaping who I am today. Ama siginalo. Thank you.
Congratulations, Emily. I would now like to invite Dr. Prashanth Bhatt to the podium to present the awards for excellence in journalism.
Good evening, everyone. I'm a relatively new faculty member in the Department of Communication. I joined in the midst of a pandemic, and believe me, it's so nice to see so many people in face-to-face sittings like this. And I want to congratulate all the students who have achieved so much despite all the challenges, especially in the last 2 years. And congratulations to their family members who've supported them and stood with them to ensure that they are successful. I'm here to announce the names of students for their excellence in journalism. Journalism, as you all know, has been going through a radical shift in the last few years, be it with media convergence, also because of several attacks on media, also with the onset of fake news, disinformation, social media, and so on and so forth. So it's even more important today for us to have excellent journalists who can tell good stories, who can put the information out there, who can fact check, and who can bring out important information to the people so citizens can make informed decisions. And therefore, we need to train good journalists, and I'm sure and confident that the names that I'm announcing now are the ones who will make us all proud, who will be good journalists, and who will tell the stories as they need to be told. It is my distinct honor and pleasure to now announce the names of students for their excellence in journalism. Sophia Henry. Aicha Lee. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bhatt. The next item in our program is bittersweet. Truly, it is my honor and my sorrow to recognize the retirement of Dr. Edmund Chabot. Dr. Chabot cannot be here with us today, but today we honor his presence, and somewhat appropriately, he will get to watch this on video. Edmund Chabot joined the Department of Communication in the fall of 1996, 26 years ago. And this semester, this one, the spring of 22, marks his 52nd semester teaching at Eastern. To say that Edmund came to Eastern well prepared is pretty much the understatement of the century. Edmund's master's degree is from the Annenberg School of Communication at the University of Pennsylvania. The Annenberg School at UPenn continues to be one of the leading, if not the leading, communication program in the world. And one of his thesis advisors was one of the leading, if not the leading, media effects scientists and theorists in the world, Dr. George Gerbner. The students in this room continue to study Gerbner to this day, and Gerbner was one of Edmund's professors. Edmund brought that to Eastern. But it does not stop there. Edmund's doctoral program at Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois, is no less impressive. In the mid-1990s, Edmund was already thinking about and studying the media world that we are living with today, the 500-channel television universe. Edmund was a little bit off on the number because I think we're around 5,000, but right on the money. Edmund has a unique base of theory and thought, and he brought that with him to Eastern. And the students of the communication program have benefited from that in ways that will continue to vibrate into the future. But Edmund, for anyone who knows him, is a writer at heart. Edmund's passion, Edmund's love, is the written word. Edmund's thing is to play with letters and words in the same way that children play with Legos. Edmund is a playwright, a scriptwriter, and an author, but he's an artist. He's an artist with words. And that passion for writing, that passion for storytelling, that passion for playing with words, Edmund brought that to Eastern. Theatrical scripts, linguistics, phonetic study, glyphs, poetry, song lyrics, radio plays, journalism, experimental film, experimental video, experimental audio, video installations, modernism, postmodernism, structuralism, post-structuralism, ekphrasis. That's a real word, ekphrasis. What? Is that a real word? Yeah, it's Greek. It means a vivid, often dramatic verbal description of a visual work of art, either real or imagined. How far out is this, professor? Well, let me read you a title of just one of his presentations. This one caught my eye because he is listed as the creator, writer, performer, and producer. The title is Recharging the Sensorium, a 40-minute long presentation on ekphrastic intertextuality using 10 channels of video, 8 channels of pre-recorded audio, and 2 channels of live audio, all based on Edmund's written work. Performance, write, performance, write, performance. As Edmund would say, can you dig it? Edmund's life at Eastern would have been recognized by many as what some professors call the life of the mind. And while he did spend time in his office surrounded by piles of paper, piles of books, piles of notes, and piles of ideas, he spent time all over this campus, surrounded by slightly smaller, more portable piles of the same stuff. But if he was not in his office, you would find him in the library, the natural habitat of a professor like Dr. Chabot. But I used to catch him late on Thursday nights in his office, typically writing, but on more than one occasion, I caught him listening to or watching football. What? Edmund, the sort of out there professor, a football fan? Intrigued, I asked him about it once and he said, "Oh, I'm not only a football fan, I used to play football." The man never ceased to surprise me. Edmund guided our curriculum, and for years, Edmund guided the Campus Lantern newspaper. He created courses in script writing, performance, journalism principles, emergent media reporting, social media strategies, and he is truly a force to be reckoned with when it comes to communication theory. As I get older, I find myself thinking about the legacies that professors leave behind. And the legacy of a professor like Edmund is as indelible as the words written in ink. And that legacy is written. It is written across the minds now of thousands of students. The academically famous Canadian rhetorical theorist Marshall McLuhan is known for writing a book and authoring a theory called The Medium is the Message. But for Edmund, it really does make sense to somewhat rephrase that idea. For Edmund, the medium is the man. Congratulations in your retirement, Edmund. We will bring this award to him. It says, one student, one professor, one book, and one pen can change the world. Congratulations, Edmund. I would now like to invite Dr. Terry Tolles-Patkin to the podium to present the award for excellence in research.
Thank you. Come on up, Jess. Jessica Tebow came to me last summer and said, I'm interested in how, really, come all the way up. I would have embarrassed you in public.
It's fair.
I'm interested in how the throwaway comments we say to our children influence how they behave as adults. So when we say to a kid something like, man up or act ladylike, what does that do for us over this lifespan? How we perceive the world, how we interact with other people, what we see as real and what we see as possible. And so she started looking into this as a student in advanced interpersonal communication. It's a small seminar course. Students prepare independent research. And Jess did something that I have never seen any student do previously. She did two focus groups, one men and one women. But these were not college sophomores. These were adult men and women with life experience and work experience, and she asked them to reflect on these kinds of issues and had a really interesting conversation. I was privileged to be able to listen in on these interviews, and they were amazing. She then took it beyond the classroom to present not one but two professional presentations. One she just completed a couple of weeks ago at the National Conference on Undergraduate Research, which was titled Gendered Microaggressions and Their Origins and Influences in Modern American Society. Quite the ambitious title. And her second presentation, she was able to extend this focus group research, and this will go live on Friday at Eastern's own CREATE undergraduate conference, Gender Differences in Reporting of Harassment and Microaggressions in the Workforce. And I'll just share what I see as the headliner of this research that's much deeper than what I'll be able to talk about right now. But women experienced a lot of workplace harassment, both microaggressions and straight out macro aggressions in the workforce. The men didn't have that experience in the workplace, but a lot of the men said they experienced these kinds of slights and challenges to their identity in their other roles. If they were out with their children, they were asked if they were babysitting the kids that day, or if they had trouble fixing something, they were given this, sort of questioning look like, you're a guy, why can't you fix everything in the house? So I think this is the start of a really big project, and I hope you follow this through. So congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tolles-Patkin. I would now like to invite Dr. Jaime Gomez to the podium to present the awards for excellence in video.
Do you see anybody here? Good evening. The students receiving this award are being recognized for their outstanding achievement in video production. They are Elvis Aperil, Janiel Chase, Eden Eden Fritz Eckyer, and Julia Simpson. Okay. I can really attest to their academic and professional growth in this area. As I closely observed and followed their aesthetics and technical development in their video production undertakings, each one of them has shown a very particular disposition to their creative approach. So I'm gonna be calling you one by one, and I'm gonna say a little bit about why are you getting this award. And so I'm gonna call Elvis. And Elvis was very mindful of technical and aesthetic variables to consider in his rather ambitious project filled with meaningful images and dialogues. So he embarked on a project that he felt very passionate about. His family journey across the continent in search of the American dream, an immigrant dream. The story was very personal, yet had a very universal touch. The mission on all ends was accomplished. Yeah. Janelle Chase. Janelle happened to be a person who cares very much about human social conditions, and this was pretty much reflected in her digital storytelling endeavors. She understands the challenges involved, as she explained in her reflection essay. I quote, "The entire process of taking my vision from my head to paper to then planning accordingly to see it through, that includes shooting and editing, and not to mention recruiting as much people as possible to match the vision, is truly a challenge, to say the least." She became very good at doing it, and her final project, a documentary intended to raise awareness about domestic violence, very much attest to all the traits aforementioned. Eden. Eden projects, Eden is always smiling. So Eden's projects were built with humorous perspectives, thorough planning and execution, and skillful editing. This was evidenced in her short film that shared the journey of a college student taking communication research and is assigned a 15-page research story. The very story documented the process of procrastination on an assignment until 2 weeks before it is due, although the student has had the entire semester. I guess most likely many students in this audience can relate to this story. Thank you. Okay. And last but not least, okay, Julia. Julia shone because of her craft and passion for cleverly and aesthetically depicting two emotional aspects of human nature, drama and romance. In order to include these elements in her film, she spent a whole semester watching Hollywood films, such as Breakfast at Tiffany's. Moreover, her final project was influenced by her interest in history of film in the United States and built with her strong production skills. That's all. Julia? Yeah. In summary, they have all displays an enormous amount of creativity and talent. And for that, the communication department takes great pride in honoring you at this event. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Gomez. The next item on our program for me is going to be a tough one. As it was just a few moments ago with Dr. Chabot, today it is my great honor and also my great sorrow to recognize the retirement of Dr. Jaime S. Gomez. Dr. Gomez joined the Department of Communication at Eastern in the fall of 99, 23 years ago. And this semester, this one, the spring of 22, marks his 46th semester teaching at Eastern. Now, personally, I am only in my 20th year here at Eastern. So you might think, logically, that I have only known Jaime for 20 years. But that would be incorrect. You see, I actually met Jaime for the very first time 28 years ago in the fall of 94 in Salt Lake City. I am sorry to say, in full disclosure, that I've actually known Jaime longer than I've known my wife. You see, Jaime and I went to graduate school together at the University of Utah in the mid-1990s, and that's where my path crossed with his for the first time. And I can tell you stories. But what happens in graduate school stays in graduate school. The second time that our paths crossed was right here in Willimantic when I arrived in 2002. And one more absolutely bizarre thing. He and I also share the same professional background in live multi-camera television production. And both of us were directors. Jaime used to live and work in South America, in the Republic of Colombia. And I used to work in North America, in the District of Columbia. Go figure. Now, I've already told you that Dr. Gomez has been a professor here at Eastern for 23 years, but he was teaching long, long before I met him in Utah. And he was working in television production, documentary film, and photography well before that. So to say that Dr. Gomez brought experience to Eastern in the fall of 99 is the next understatement of the century for the evening. Prior to Eastern, prior to Utah, Jaime was at San Francisco State University. Now, for most of you, at first glance, that may not be all that remarkable. But when I tell you the next piece of information, you might get the rest of the story. You see, unlike other academic and professional fields, there is one, and I mean only one, guru in the field of television production, Dr. Herb Zettel. And you might have guessed it, Zettel was at San Francisco State University at the same time that Jaime was. And the fact that Jaime got to work with Herb Zettel and I didn't simply still makes me green to this day, green with envy. So Jaime not only came to Eastern with a wealth of international professional media experience, he came to Eastern with a PhD from Utah, a program that in the mid-1990s was truly, truly exceptional, even if I do say so myself. And he came to Eastern with that San Francisco guru in his pocket and in his head. And when Jaime came to Eastern, let me tell you, there was work to be done. The television studio and the control room needed a serious update. The video editing facility needed a serious update. The curriculum needed to be updated. And in the space of 3 very short years, he did all of that. The studio was refitted with new lights, new cameras. The control room was refitted with thousands and thousands of dollars of new equipment. The video editing lab was refitted with new computers and new software. Jaime did that. I can count on one hand the number of professors who have the technical knowledge to actually lead renovations like this. Typically, universities hire consultants for that type of work. No worries. Dr. Gomez knew what was needed, and he made it happen. And we've done this twice. Twice. Now, the curriculum is another thing. The communication program at Eastern reflects Dr. Gomez in so many ways. Not only did he develop and update multiple courses in studio television production, he developed courses in field video production, documentary production, advanced video editing, directing, and media aesthetics. Remember that Zettel guy? Zettel was the creator of applied media aesthetics practice and theory in the United States. And Jaime brought that to Eastern's communication program as well. And I think I heard him use the word aesthetics a few times when he was talking about the students. Jaime is a professor and a practitioner. In a slight twist on the more common phrase, practice what you preach, when it comes to Dr. Gomez, he quite literally practices what he teaches. Jaime is an award-winning documentary producer. He produced and hosted the Alma Latina program produced right here at Eastern. And most recently, he worked to create a film and a multimedia exhibit that was presented in Connecticut, California, and in Colombia. He has written book chapters, journal articles, served on countless panels, and has co-authored one of the best textbooks in our field. Jaime's rare. He's a recognized scholar nationally and internationally. And for Eastern to have a person like Dr. Gomez is, well, a very fortunate thing for Eastern. Jaime's profile at Eastern was recognized early. He was department chair. He was the interim dean of the School of Education and Professional Studies. He was the founder of and the director of the New Media Studies program. And then he was our department chair again. Dr. Gomez's track record of service to Eastern is truly exceptional, but the borders of our campus could not contain him. A long history of volunteering in the Willimantic community is another one of his outstanding accomplishments. So it's not enough just to stay on campus and teach. He's got to go off campus and serve the students in the local community as well. And a word about his students. I honestly don't know how many times Dr. Gomez took students of his on trips. Trips to Mexico, trips to Nevada, for the National Association of Broadcasters meeting, trips to ESPN in Bristol, advising student groups, excuse me, countless Saturdays so the students would be able to produce content in the studio. And one of those student programs, it was a game show, came in third in a national competition in Vegas. On a side note, and I know this from my own experience, it really does take a brave professor to take students to Vegas. So hats off on that one. And I could tell you stories, but I won't, because what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. Finally, I owe my presence here today to Jaime, and I want to thank him for bringing me to Eastern. You see, when I ran into Jaime in Vegas in the spring of 2002, I was not happy in my current job, and I was in a suit, probably this one, and I was interviewing for new jobs. And Jaime said to me, "I thought you were in Arizona." And I said to him, "I thought you were in Colombia." And he said to me, "No, man, I'm at Eastern Connecticut State University." And I said, "Where's that?" And he said, "In Willimantic." And I said, "Where's that?" And he said, "No, man, it's good. And we need a guy like you. So for bringing me here, thank you, Jaime. When I arrived, the work was done. His work. All I had to do was walk in here and teach. So while I could tell you stories about graduate school, while I could tell you stories about Vegas, and I won't, I will tell you this one, though. One time in Salt Lake City, I ran into Jaime and asked him a normal conversation starter. I said, "What'd you do over the weekend?" And he said to me, what he said to me has left an impression on me to this day, and it still makes me smile. It really does. He said, "I went dancing." And I said, "What?" And he said, "I went salsa dancing." And so I've been forever left with this image of Jaime out on the town in Salt Lake City on a Saturday night dancing some version of the Mambo. As I mentioned earlier, I find myself thinking about legacies that professors leave behind. And professors like Dr. Gomez, it's all too tempting to point to the editing labs or the studios or the buildings or the curriculum or the equipment, but I've come to realize that it is not those things that last or that even really matter. For Dr. Gomez, the legacies are the students, the thousands of students that have been fortunate enough to have crossed his path. Congratulations on your retirement, Jaime. What the award says, what the award says, I think is appropriate. It's engraved with a little inscription. It says, "The meaning of life is to find your gift, and the purpose of life is to give it away." Now, I would now like to invite Dr. Terry Tolles-Peck into the podium to begin the Honor Society inductions.
Thank you. It's my pleasure and privilege to be the advisor to the Honor Society, and they are a formidable group of people, let me tell you. Today, the students we're recognizing are truly the best of the brightest, not just among Eastern students or Connecticut students, but among communication students nationwide. There are over 500 chapters of Lambda Pi Eta at colleges and universities nationwide. Eastern's 32 new members have met strict national standards for academic achievement in order to be inducted into the Honor Society. In addition, each student must demonstrate interest in the field of communication, commitment to professional development, and uphold the highest standards of ethical behavior. Each one of these students is impressive individually. You'll find their names in many places around campus. They perform in plays, play on sports teams, and are active in our co-curricular media groups. They volunteer on campus and off to make the world a better place. Many of them manage all this while holding down a full-time course load, plus a job or internship. Lambda Pi Eta was founded with Aristotle's three principles of rhetoric in mind, emphasizing not only intellectual achievements, but strong ethical character traits. Our students demonstrated that this year by coming up with creative ways to give back to the community. They organized a photo session where students could have professional headshots taken, and due to popular demand, offered a second one. They've had fundraisers to build the group's resources for future years, built a sense of community by designing t-shirts and sweatshirts with our logo, and maintained an active social media presence. They organized a food drive to benefit Sean's Cupboard, the on-campus food pantry. It's that concern for others that makes these students such a vital part of the Department of Communication and the Eastern community. It is now my pleasure and my privilege to introduce our chapter officers, Madison, Janelle, Jillian, Minar, and Haley, who will present the induction ceremony.
Lambda Pi Eta is the official Communication Honor Society of the National Communication Association. It was founded in 1985 at the University of Arkansas, and in 1996, Lambda Pi Eta was inducted in the Association of College Honor Societies. Today, there are over 500 chapters worldwide. Eastern's chapter, Tau Nu, was inaugurated in 2005. The name Lambda Pi Eta is represented by the Greek letters L, Lambda, P, Pi, and H, Eta, symbolizing what Aristotle described in his work, Rhetoric, as the three modes of persuasion. Logos, meaning logic, pathos, relating to emotion, and ethos, defined as character, credibility, and ethics.
The first mode of persuasion is logos, or logic, in all aspects of scholarship and its application to one's life. Logic plays a major role in deliberations and problem solving.
Pathos, or emotional appeal, the second symbol of our organization's title, encompasses the driving force of an organization that makes it vital and effective.
I forgot my reading glasses, so my bad. The last mode of persuasion is ethos, or character, credibility, and ethics. Aristotle sees character credibility as a primary means of affecting change in society and in one's life. Thus, it is appropriate that ethos is a major symbol of Lambda Pi Eta. The purpose of the Honor Society, according to our Constitution, are to recognize, foster, and reward outstanding scholastic achievements, to stimulate interest in the field of communication, to provide an opportunity to discuss and exchange ideas in the field of communication, to promote and encourage professional development among communication majors, to establish and maintain close relationships and mutual understanding between faculty and students, to explore options for further graduate education.
The membership in Lambda Pi Eta is composed of undergraduate students who have declared an interest in the field of communication and have achieved a high level of academic excellence. To be eligible for membership, students must have completed 60 semester hours of undergraduate credit courses, have a cumulative grade point average of at least 3.0, have completed the equivalent of 12 semester hours in courses in communication, have a grade point average of at least 3.25 in these courses, and be currently enrolled as a full-time student in good standing with their institution.
At this time, I would like to invite Dr. Utterback, the chair of the Communication Department, to call the new members forward to receive their certificate of membership, honor cord, and membership pin.
Jacob Alibrio. Chanel Monique Brown. Lauren Christie. Matthew Coleman. Jenna De La Cruz. Jack Dahmers. Zachary Doty. Kyle Scott Ferguson. Catherine Elizabeth Furman. Julia M. Florence. Ryan Gable. Josiah Gardner. Zachary Gear Loriano. Emily Hailu. Jillian McGuyan. Gabrielle Medina. Jacqueline S. Navickas. Alexis Nimitz. Olivia Jane Pendle. Marcus Prezioso. Mark Anthony Richards. Patricia Marilyn Rotanto. Nancy Scanlon. Colby Scott. Julia R. Simpson. Megan Solensky. Sarah Stevens. Janina Timbro. Haley Tatro. Ivor Valdivia. Alyssa Ann Vilches. Dylan James Walsh. I would now like to invite the President of the Honor Society to invoke the pledge.
As newly inducted members of Lambda Pi Eta, do you accept the challenge to maintain the high academic and leadership standards set forth by the organization and to serve as examples of the achievement of excellence in the field of communication? And do you promise to work towards the achievement of the purposes and goals as set down by the national organization of Lambda Pi Eta? If so, please answer, I do. I now present to you the newly inducted members of the Tau Nu chapter of Lambda Pi Eta for the 2021-2022 academic year. Welcome and congratulations.
It's photo time. I was about to make a snarky remark, but I won't. That was wonderful. As the students retake their seats, we are coming to the conclusion of today's festivities. But today's ceremony would not be possible without the contributions of our department secretary, Robin Merritt. Please join me in thanking Robin. Thank you, Robin. Finally, I would like to offer my sincere congratulations to the students honored here today. To those of you that are graduating seniors, all of our collective good wishes for the future. Thank all of you for coming to the 2022 Department of Communication Annual Celebration of Excellence and Honor Society Induction Ceremony. Have a great evening, folks.